Blackstone presents The Awake Dreamer, A Guide to Lucid Dreaming, Astral Travel, and Mastering the Dreamscape by Samantha Fey. This book is read by Christine Williams. For my children, Olivia, Victoria, and Chloe, my dreams come true. Introduction. We all know that dreams can help us solve problems, relieve stress, and inspire creations. But it wasn't until a dream experience I had in the late 1990s that I started to wonder if there was something much more going on when we dream. One evening, I dreamed I was walking in what appeared to be a subway tunnel with my spirit guide. It was an ordinary tunnel with off-white subway tiles, like Penn Station in New York. In the dream, I walked past a friend who was also walking with her guide. I waved, and she returned my greeting. That was the entirety of my dream recall. But for some reason, the vividness of the dream, seeing my friend walking with her guide in this tunnel that felt so familiar to me, stayed with me all day. When I bumped into her at work that afternoon, I told her about it. Before I could finish, she interrupted by finishing my dream story. "I know," she said, "because I had the same dream last night, too." How could the two of us have identical dreams on the same night? Had we instead recalled actually having traveled to the other side with our guides? I've had vivid dreams my whole life. Growing up, I knew I was intuitive. But back then, I chalked up my dreams as part of my active imagination. I dreamed frequently of these glowing beings who visited me at night to bring me comfort. When we moved halfway through my second grade year, I dreamed that I awoke to find four of these beings seated at the foot of my bed. They were faceless and shapeless, yet they didn't scare me. I never heard them speak aloud. Their words simply appeared in my mind. They told me that I would soon have a new teacher. The next day, when I arrived at school, I was told I was being switched from Mrs. Martin's class to Mrs. Burroughs' class. Throughout elementary school, I often dreamed that I visited a special place just for children. I knew that only children were allowed in this safe haven. We met in a building located in a beautiful park nestled in a forest where we could play games or just sit and talk. Some played hopscotch or jumped rope. Others clustered around the pinball machines or basketball hoops, while the younger ones played hide and seek. These dreams stopped when I entered middle school, but I never forgot them. Years later, I met one of my best friends at our children's neighborhood playgroup. As she and I were sitting in a park watching our kids play, for some reason, I started telling her about my dreams of a similar place I had dreamed of when I was a child. Just like my coworker, she started finishing my sentences. "I used to go there too when I was a little girl," she said. "We've been friends for almost 20 years now, and we still talk about this experience. When we met, I instantly felt as if I knew her, and we became fast friends within weeks." Could it be that I had indeed known her from these dream visits when we were children? Both of these women are intelligent, rational people. My former co-worker has a PhD and describes herself as spiritually agnostic. My playgroup friend is a practicing Christian with degrees in science and nursing. I have a master's degree in education and consider myself grounded, smart, and, well, normal. Yet we three have had these strange, mystical experiences that connect us. While I was teaching at a community college, I began studying Reiki, a form of hands-on healing. Our Reiki teacher instructed us to meditate each night for 21 days to facilitate our healing energy. I'd never meditated with any consistency before this, but as soon as I started to go within, my dreaming life strengthened dramatically. I dreamed a friend was pregnant a month before she knew. I dreamed my neighbors were moving weeks before the husband got a new job. In a dream, a deceased family member told me an aunt would pass suddenly and unexpectedly. Then, in the summer of 2005, I began having a recurring dream of someone being shot in the neck. I never saw a face in these dreams, just the same horrifying image of a bullet impacting someone's neck. These dreams were always short and always the same. I saw a bullet hitting a man's neck in slow motion, followed by a hand grasping the neck to staunch the flow of blood. At the time, I was married to a police sergeant named Mike who believed he was invincible and rarely wore his bulletproof vest. After these dreams, I began begging him to wear the vest on his midnight shifts. I also made sure he wore his Archangel Michael medallion for extra protection. When my doorbell rang at 1 a.m. one morning, I think a part of me knew that my dream had come true. Mike had been shot in the neck by a criminal who'd escaped arrest earlier that day. Many miracles occurred that night that contributed to Mike's survival. As family and friends gathered around me in the hospital to pray with me, I slipped away to the chapel and knelt down. I surrendered all I was and all I feared to God, praying, "Dear God, please let Mike live. If you want me to be an intuitive, I will do that. Help me make sense of these dreams, and I will work with you. But please help him live." As a cradle Catholic, making bargains with God came easily to me. Thankfully, God listened, because Mike survived. Soon after, I signed up for an intuitive development class at a local metaphysical store. Not long after I joined these classes, I began having a series of dreams that I call my psychic school dreams. I felt as if I were being trained during the day by my teachers and at night by my astral guides. Eventually, I walked away from my secure, wonderful teaching career and embarked on a new path as an intuitive. As my dream world amplified, it led me to investigate dreams on a much deeper level. But this spiritual awakening was very hard for me. In a short span of time, I went from being a normal wife, mother, and teacher to being this weird intuitive working in a small office above a yoga studio. I struggled deeply with my faith and even confessed my new work to a priest. Luckily, he was incredibly kind. After listening to me confess to studying tarot, crystals, and mediumship, he paused for a moment and said, "So what are your sins, my dear?" I stumbled over my response before blurting out, "Didn't I just confess them?" The elderly priest smiled at me and leaned forward on his elbows.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.